Artemis Fowl. Wow. What a great story, you know, filled with so much magic and excitement and interesting lore and... Wait, we're talking about the 2020 movie?
Yeah, pretty much.
Fuck.
I honestly don't know how to feel about this, guys. I mean, when it comes to films like this, it really is difficult to not come off as feeling like a bully.
I don't like bullies.
But then again, I don't like any of the movies that I was forced to put on this list anyways, and my general distaste can be shared with how Disney is currently handling their live-action properties. The now global box office smashing money-making movie monopoly is... Well, they've basically gotten their own heads so far up as a mousetrap that they've literally forgotten what made their own stories work so well in the past, and even when they do realize it, they almost intentionally half-assed it to oblivion, just to spite us. Now, I've seen my fair share of Disney live-action remakes, some of which I thought were okay, while the rest I showed a very moderate disdain for. But for some reason, some strange reason, I think out of all the live-action Disney movies that I've seen, Artemis Fowl is the one I hate the most. Now, that, as of right now, does not go that long of a way from me saying that it's officially the worst I've seen, but everything about how this movie was structured, how it was presented, the way it left me feeling at the end, really struck home for me why so many people have been turning against Disney in droves in recent years. It really boggles the mind beyond anything I once thought possible. How could such a beloved revolutionary studio continue to turn into such defunct, broken pieces of crap? You thought if anybody could pull it off, it would be Disney. Unfortunately, there are some things that not even the Mouse House can fix. So, young Artemis Fowl Jr., son of criminal mastermind Artemis Fowl Sr. I'm sorry, I can't even finish the joke. Like, I can't even, like put together a basic summary for the plot, okay? There's too much going on and not much going on at the same time. I can't really say I blame them, though, because this was another one of those films that laid dormant in the gate of development hell for the past two decades. What a fall from grace.
Artemis Fowl simply sucks. There's absolutely nothing else, nothing positive about this film. Everything from the writing, the acting, the CGI, the editing, the story, the pacing, the music, all of these aspects are either painfully generic or just straight up terrible.
I haven't read an Artemis Fowl book in, oh god, a decade, but I know that this terrible, poorly written, soulless piece of trash is not what the books are meant to be when you adapt them to a film. What is this movie even about? Is it about anything? Because I can't really remember a plot that much. There is probably about 30 minutes of plot stretched out over the course of 90 minutes, and it just feels like forever.
But we're getting a little too ahead of ourselves here. The acting is a complete joke, but through no fault of the actors themselves, with the exception of Judi Dench. Her gruff voice and stagnant attempts at expressionism for about 90% of this movie is a testament to her possibly screaming, "I had no intention of being in this movie at all." Problem is, I wish I could say the same for everybody else. The cast they got here isn't all that bad in concept, and sometimes I can find little nuggets here and there that highlights some strength and dedication to the project, but the execution behind everything just overwrites all of that. And then we get to the elephant in the room. Verdia Shaw. I really don't want to harp on child actors, but jeez Louise, Verdia was terrible here. I feel so bad for this kid. His first feature film from one of the biggest film studios in the world, and he completely drops the ball here. It's bad enough that his character was an insecure, dependent boy who was nothing at all like the criminal, cold, steadily determined, witty mastermind of the books, but he was so inept and so clueless about his direction in more than at least half of his scenes, I was almost convinced that he was robotic.
Let's talk about Artemis Fowl himself. This is his movie, he is the titular character, but he is the worst part about this already trash movie. We get introduced to him, and we are immediately put off by the fact that he is a dick. He is unlikable, he is an asshole, and quite frankly, he has basically zero redeeming qualities as a character, and only kind of becomes tolerable in the last 10 minutes. I feel so terrible for this kid because this is his first film role, and granted, this would have been a great opportunity for him, but he is so bad in this movie.
I may have been over-exaggerating on the acting a little bit, because there are instances where, again, you can tell they're trying to get a good performance out of their character. All of which would have mattered more if said characters actually had a quirk or a trait or a personality or some kind of art to drive them, because there's nothing like that here. Most of the characters are either strictly two-dimensional in spades, while they're mostly one-dimensional at heart, favoring the loosely defined hero and side characters and even vaguer villain and no shreds of nuance to balance them out. We're barely given anything on Artemis or anyone else for that matter, other than what we're told, and even in the rare instance when a character does give up a personality through their actions, it isn't enough to fully solidify them as a character of genuine importance because of the supreme lack of care and effort but put on them, especially if certain characters have abilities that are rarely put to use until the very last minute. Artemis is supposed to be a genius, and his intelligence gives him the ability to strategize in ways that no one could anticipate. Holly is supposed to be brave, problem-solving, and determined to show her loyalty to her fellow fairies. The butlers are loyal and dedicated to the fowls. Josh Gad is a digger. Root's the one in charge. Like, that's literally all we get out of these characters. Like, the exposition here, I swear to God. The film uses Josh Gad to spend like the first full 30 minutes dumping a bucketload of information at the audience, outright telling us about how much Artemis is a genius and a criminal mastermind, how the world of fairies operates, what his own character is doing stuck in prison. He had to go on and on about what a character is, how they act, how and why they're the way they are, what environment displays, how important it is to the land, what a certain object does or doesn't do, and he yammers excessively about it to the point of annoyance. Every little detail is stressed and spelled out to such an obnoxious degree. It's actually kind of awkward to sit through, and that's an accurate assumption about the dialogue in general. Jarring and unnatural. Look, in the world of film, it's common for most movies to have some sort of exposition to explain a certain element of the plot or scene so the characters themselves can catch up to what the audience already knows or at least have a suspicion of. It's an entirely different ballgame if you have to keep yammering on about every little detail in every little scene for every single second you get. No wonder why you don't care about the characters, the environment, or even the bloody stakes involved with the plot of the MacGuffin quest. The film thinks you're an imbecile!
Then we get to the villain. Wait, who was the villain again? Oh, yes. Hooded person. That is all that I could say for the villain of this movie. The main antagonist of this movie. They wear a hood. That's it. That is literally it. We don't get any revelations as to who they are. Artemis never even meets the main villain of this movie. It is so badly executed. The villain is just there so that we can have a reason to have some conflict in this movie. But then, what is their goal? Why did they do all this? Who are they? When is Artemis even gonna talk to them through something that isn't like a phone call? It's so badly executed. This is not how you do the main villain of a movie.
I wish I had more to say on the technical aspects regarding this movie, as is, there isn't really enough there for me to really leave a comment about, but I'm gonna try anyways, because I assume you like hearing me talk, and I'm nowhere near done with this malodorous tripe. I will say I didn't come across a lot of issues regarding the cinematography or the set design, but when it comes to a company like Disney, it's like, can you expect anything less? However, there was a lot of digital hacking involving with the firing and the editing regarding this movie. While not as violently disjointed as The Predator or constant eye-rape like Resident Evil The Final Chapter, it's definitely behind-the-scenes worthy. It features some of the most jarring fight choreography I've ever seen, some really curious and mucked-up editing with obvious ADR or automated dialogue replacement uttered in the background, and all of this serves as a purpose to either sanitize Artemis' character to make him the next Harry Potter, or to appeal to a younger audience, because God knows we can't have an antagonist as our main character for our next big franchise, even though more than half of the heroes we've gotten from the 2010s comprise almost entirely of anti-heroes! And then there's the rotten, molding cherry on top. The film butchers the plot of the first two books, abandoning the original character and clubbing together its broken story shards and spare parts so haphazardly that the film barely even has much of a story to speak of. It borrows elements from Men in Black, Journey to the Center of the Earth, Harry Potter, and Home Alone, mashed up with the most generic elements of each franchise lazily strung together as if it were something new and special, when in reality, this lesser man Spy Kids ripoff has no earthly idea just how out of date it feels. There were like multiple instances throughout this movie that flat out told me it didn't know whether it wanted to be another forgettable kids' fantasy adventure, one of the most frustrating young adult book the film adaptations yet, or just a major annoyance. And honestly, I'm positive it's all those attributes combined.
I'm still trying to comprehend how they got a competent director like Kenneth Branagh and a pretty solid cast could end up so terribly. You would expect at least an average film, right? I sure as hell did. Thank God this film got dumped in Disney Plus instead of theaters, because I certainly would have paid money to see it because I was actually excited for it. This film, though, isn't my least favorite film of the year. It is certainly complete and utter garbage that deserves a spot on the greatest train wrecks in film history.
this is on the same type of level as something that I would expect from Birdemic, but it is in this Disney Plus live action, pretty big budget movie by Disney. What happened?
When I first finished Artemis Fowl, I had felt a very strong dislike for it. Now I actively hate the film's Weasley black guts out because this is Disney actively screaming we did not give a crap throughout the entire majority of this hellacious production debacle, and they were not subtle about that. It is the most obviously commercialized, generic, bland piece of crap they could have possibly put out, and they could not have picked the worst year to do so. The fact that it's nearly been 7 years now, and they still refuse to take even the tiniest bit of accountability with their own projects is just becoming insulting.
This is not how you do a movie. You don't just build up, and then cut off at the end. That's just bad writing, and also showing everyone that you just want to make money.
The studio was, and in some ways still is, a pioneer of animation, responsible for bringing our favorite childhood and nostalgic memories to life. So it's not hard to see why so many people are pissed off. We want to like Disney. We want to keep those precious memories with the Mouse House alive. We want to be able to appreciate the work for how far they've come and how much they've changed the game. But when they push out cookie-cutter bullcrap like this, when we find out that it's not only bad, but uncaringly bad, there's no wonder why people have been wisening up to Disney's questionable business practice of
they liked it once, they'll like it again, but shinier!
I was going to go against my better judgment and watch Artemis again to see if I could find any redeeming qualities that I could muster, but after thinking back to how I sunk what felt like 2.5 hours forcing myself away trying to get invested into a story that was going absolutely nowhere, I cannot stand the thought of ever touching this film again. I will concede that the film somehow has a niche audience. And if you're outside that niche, then you're about as welcome as Matthew Broderick in a Godzilla movie.